I'm Dr. David Blumenthal, president of the Commonwealth Fund. We're a foundation focused on improving America's health and assuring that everyone has access to affordable, high-quality care. Throughout our 100-year history, we've always looked abroad in our quest for better care in the United States. This is because our work has consistently shown that people in other countries live longer lives and healthier lives than Americans, and they spend less on healthcare. So we ask ourselves, how? What are they doing right? What can we learn from it? Of course, COVID-19 has taken that conversation to another level. Governments the world over have grappled with the pandemic's immense challenges. We've watched healthcare systems get it right, get it wrong, and everything in between. We're excited to underwrite this program with PBS NewsHour. It allows us to dig more deeply into the stories behind the country's successes and failures, and to see what we can learn. Thank you for joining us. And now I'd like to introduce PBS NewsHour's William Brangham, who will begin this important conversation. William?
Thank you, David, and special thanks to the Commonwealth Fund for your support on our healthcare reporting and for underwriting this live stream today. We are talking today about healthcare in America and the possibility of healthcare reform to bring more people under the umbrella of health insurance coverage and to lower costs and to make the system more equitable for all. I'm joined today, luckily, by three wonderful collaborators on this project. The first of them is someone you may recognize, Dr. Ashish Jha. He is the Dean of Brown University's School of Public Health, and he was a collaborator on this reporting from the very beginning with us. Welcome. Great to have you back. Secondly is Tsung-Mei Cheng. She is a health policy analyst at Princeton University and has advised governments here and abroad on healthcare reform, and she was also a participant in our critical care documentary. Great to see you, Mei. And Jason Kane, he is the longtime NewsHour healthcare producer and was the creator of the original series that kicked all of this off, as well as the producer of the documentary Critical Care. So glad to finally drag Jason from behind the camera and get him out in front so that we can learn from his expertise as well. Great to have all three of you here. Before we get to questions with the three of you, I'd like to play just the very beginning of our documentary, Critical Care, which will give you a good sense of the scope and issues that we raised in that project. Let's take a look at that.
Let me feel underneath your arm.
It's a uniquely American problem. The richest country in the world leaves tens of millions with no health insurance.
It makes me feel that we don't matter.
The thing about surgical theater is
a country
that
with such remarkable innovation.
They don't know a discharge date.
And yet so many are struggling.
Every one of us can name some people we saw suffer to death.
You know, the deck's stacked against you.
This is America's day.
As a new administration takes over, promising reform, we travel to four very similar nations with four very different health systems for clues.
I love how open and explicit they are about the fact that there are always choices.
Did you have a good sleep?
How do they care for virtually everyone and do it for less money?
No one says, well, that's going to cost too much, so we're not going to do it.
Here it's a bit more humane. It's like, look, you know, there's a basic level of care that people deserve. It costs, but you still deserve it.
And amid a pandemic, does universal coverage help save lives?
If you require an ICU stay, if you need to be intubated and ventilated, all of those things are covered under the public system.
We have a problem. What lessons can we learn from abroad? Critical Care, America versus the world.
So that gives you a little look at some of the issues that we were touching on. And as I mentioned, the genesis of this whole project was to look at the disparities that exist in American healthcare. We saw in our reporting in Houston, Texas, the sort of incredible contrast where you have these remarkable technological innovations alongside a population of people who can't afford health care and find themselves getting sicker and dying at far greater rates than their nearby neighbors in Texas. But that problem is really a problem that is writ large in the United States. And so joining us on this conversation, please feel free to add questions. You can tweet them to us, put them down in the comments below, and we'll try to get them as we go through here. But first off, Ashish Jha, I wonder if you would just take a crack at trying to address this first question, which keeps coming up, which is, why is it that we do have these disparities in American healthcare, the high and the low? Why does that exist?
Yeah. So, William, I would say on some level, it's a decision we have made in our country. We have largely seen healthcare as an individual responsibility. And with that, we've tied it to employer-based insurance for people certainly under 65. And that has meant that if you are well insured, you get access to terrific high-quality care. If you are poorly insured, you may have difficulty accessing it. And if you're uninsured, which about 10% of Americans are, your ability to access it at all is severely limited. And this really does come from a mindset that has had individual responsibility to get health insurance at the core of it. No other high-income country that I know of does that. I mean, there is a sense of sort of social obligation that everybody needs to be able to get access to healthcare. There are disparities in other countries, but this fundamental ability to access the healthcare system, that is not seen as something that you got to figure out for yourself.
May, I wonder what you would add to that. Because as Ashish is pointing out, we are an incredibly wealthy nation, and yet we somehow stumble on this very basic ability of making sure that the vast majority of Americans don't have to worry about getting sick and going bankrupt. What is your sense as to why those disparities still exist here?
Well, I think that we Americans need to realize that we are the only nation in the industrialized, rich world that does not have universal health insurance for everyone. And I mean, today we have about a little over 9% of Americans just without health insurance. And we accept that, whereas in other countries, they do not accept that. And this has to do, I agree with everything Ashish just said, but I would like to add, just really emphasize this, the fundamental cause of this fact of lack of universal health insurance, and which is we have an ideological divide in America. See, on the one side, you have the more liberal people, Americans, who think that healthcare is a right and that you should get it when you need it. But on the other end of the spectrum, you have conservatives who think that healthcare is an individual responsibility. So you have to take care of yourself and your family. And now, of course, in between, there are, you know, a very large middle who are just undecided. They don't know what to think because they get bombarded with talks from both sides. But this is just not so in other countries. In other countries, they have it written into the law, and some countries have it written into the Constitution that healthcare is a right, but we don't have that. So our system, our healthcare system, has evolved into a system that is fundamentally based on ability to pay and not on your healthcare needs.
And Jason Kane, we've also, to all of the things that May and Ashish have been pointing out here, it is true that this chasm exists, and this is the system that we are living with today. But we have made major attempts at reform, and we have been slowly inching towards covering more and more people, right?
Yeah, certainly. You know, expanding coverage and more recently, you know, the issue of bringing down costs, these have been bipartisan issues going back as far as Teddy Roosevelt. In the middle of the last century, you had, you know, tax incentives to get employers to offer health insurance to their employees. Later, there was the creation of Medicare and Medicaid. There was legislation around community health centers to get those to spring up across the country. The Children's Health Insurance Program, and then most recently, the Affordable Care Act, which included the expansion of Medicaid even further. So we have been making incremental progress on this for many decades. But that being said, there are still, to this day, more than 30 million people who are uninsured. And there's a pretty broad political consensus that those people should at least have substantive access to health care, if not health insurance. The question is how to do that.
Indeed. Please keep your questions coming. We're already starting to get some in here. I'd like to put this first one up here. This is from Mike in Minnesota. He asks, why is our system the most expensive in the world while not the best? How is it possible that the U.S. hasn't figured out that basic health care is a human right and every other major nation has? Ashish, I'd like to turn back to you on this same question, because in this debate, you often hear a lot of simplistic arguments that are made, that there are certain bad actors in the system, that if only we could put a leash on the insurance companies or the pharmaceutical companies or the hospitals, we would somehow address that. Can you take on that issue that we talked about before, that you were arguing this is a political decision we've made? Where do you look to see that the actors who are in part responsible for these disparities?
Yeah, so, you know, look, it's a $3.5 trillion healthcare system. And it's always tempting to look for the bad guy, because then you can go after the bad guy and then you'll solve the problems. And the bottom line is that's not how this works. Everybody's acting within a set of incentives that we have created. And within those incentives, we get what we see. So let's talk a little bit about why we're so much more expensive. There are two fundamental reasons. One is complexity. We have way higher administrative costs than any other country in the world. And that's not a public thing or a private thing. There are countries with primarily private insurance that are far more efficient. There are countries with primarily public insurance that are far more efficient. We have just figured out how to do the worst of both worlds. But the other part, the real driver of high healthcare spending in America, is high prices. Everything costs more here. We pay doctors more, we pay nurses more, we pay more for CT scans, we pay more for hip surgeries. Pick anything we want, we pay more. We don't necessarily consume that much more healthcare, but we do pay a lot more for it. And that's the major driver. There are a bunch of ways of controlling high prices. You can have really efficient markets. They control high prices. We can have government price controls. They control prices. We have chosen, again, political, we have made a decision essentially to not really use either of those two tools. So if you're a conservative, you're gonna say, hey, I want more efficient markets. If you're a liberal, you might say, I want more government control of prices. Either one of them would move us towards better, more efficient healthcare spending. The bottom line is we have chosen to do the worst of both, and therefore we have really pretty outrageously high healthcare prices. That's what lands us at $3.5 trillion while still failing to cover 10% of our population.
May, the three countries that we traveled to for this documentary, four actually, Canada, the UK, Switzerland, and Australia, all to some extent use the government to be a principal tool for containing costs, as Ashish is saying, that really is a major issue here, that we have to find a way to make the delivery of medicine and the delivery of smart healthcare cost a little bit less. Conservatives might look at all those other nations and say it's not necessarily the government's responsibility to do that. Do you think that there are ways, government or otherwise, at controlling costs that are feasible here in the United States?
You know, there's a very recent survey here by the Kaiser Family Foundation that says that because of this COVID crisis, that people see the use or what the government did or could do. So that the consensus now, right now, seems to be that the Americans think that the public government should play a bigger role in our healthcare. Now, I don't know whether that will last, you know, but it is a fact that in other countries, the government, many of the other countries, the government does play a very big role in prices. Say Canada, right? Australia, England. The government really, in England, which is a single payer system, the government just decides the prices. In Canada, it's also government and negotiations. And then in Switzerland, the very interesting thing, and with something that I like to bring to the attention of Americans, and that is, please look at the Swiss healthcare system. It is 100% private health insurance system, but they, I was once talking with the Swiss health minister for an interview. I asked him, but who sets drug prices if the insurance companies are private? He looked at me as if, you know, what kind of a stupid question is that? he says, I do. Two words. I nearly fell off my chair. So in Switzerland, drug prices are set by the Ministry of Health. And this was the minister who oversees that. So then we know, just looking at the experience of the United States, that the private sector has not been very good at controlling costs. If you look at the healthcare cost growth, the private sector has growth much faster than the public program, Medicare. You know, and the one bar is just a lot higher than the other. Here's a private, here's Medicare. So I don't know. I mean, there are ways to control costs, but it's a question of whether we have the I don't know the word, just that, you know, we have the taste for it.
The taste for it or the stomach for it.
That's right.
Can I jump in on this, William? Is that okay?
Yes, please.
There are two things that strikes me. I mean, you know, one issue on the private sector's interest or willingness to control costs. If you think about it, if you're a payer, if you're a private insurance company, you have every incentive and motivation to control costs because, you know, that can go to your bottom line. So the issue is, why is the private sector not able to control costs? And then also, I mean, while Medicare has grown generally more slowly, why isn't Medicare able to do a better job? And again, I keep coming back to the broader political economy here. And the issue in my mind is twofold. First is, and some actually really nice analysis that was supported by the Commonwealth Fund showed that a vast majority of markets in America, healthcare markets, are deeply consolidated. They're non-competitive. Right? You don't have lots of competing hospitals and provider organizations. So non-competitive markets will inflate prices very hard to control prices. And then in other countries, you have a strong government price setter. And that would be the natural one here would be Medicare. The challenge with Medicare is that we have a political system that every time Medicare does anything that cuts costs, let's say cuts spending to hospitals or physicians, there's a huge political backlash. In most congressional districts, the hospital is the biggest employer. Members of Congress get bent out of shape, and all of a sudden, the political kind of freedom that Medicare has to control costs gets pretty limited. And so it really is a broader issue that goes outside of our healthcare system. It's how our democracy is organized, so part of the question is within that, since we're not going to hopefully make major changes to our democracy, the question is within the political economy we have, what are the set of choices? There are some, but it's hard to look at the healthcare system in isolation of the broader political system. Actually, one of the lessons I learned from Uwe Reinhardt was that in order to really understand the healthcare system, you have to look at the broader political landscape and understand what is possible and how you work within it.
I completely agree with Ashish. Our political system, just this morning, I read that, we have too many powerful interest groups in Washington looking after their particular segment of business. Healthcare is one of the most powerful special interest lobby groups in Washington. This morning's news, it says that one of the New Jersey senators, pharmaceutical companies have been sending him money, big checks, Pfizer, Merck, and Amgen, and others. They've been sending him, $1,000, and then two of these companies, the executives send the senator. One sent 5,000, one sent 5,800. And this is because this senator will have a very big say in how President Biden's wish to get some kind of a decision, a congressional move on controlling drug prices by the end of 2021. But then already you can see these lobby, these special interests immediately jump into action and try to influence through this political process, which in our country is legitimate. It's legal, see? Whereas, you know, in other countries in Canada, you can't do that. In Taiwan, you just cannot do that. They have a different system, the parliamentary system. But here, we, like Uwe Reinhardt would say, that we can buy politicians piecemeal. You can put them in your pocket. I mean, so that is just the reality that we have to live with.
And Jason Kane, if I may, one of the things that you and I talked about quite a bit as we were traveling is that each of the nations that we visited, it's not like they didn't have to deal with those same actors in the system. They have hospitals and pharmaceutical companies and, in some cases, insurance companies, but that they somehow managed to address the concerns of those without putting them necessarily out of business.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, I definitely agree with both Ashish and May that these are very challenging obstacles to overcome. But I think it's worth pointing out that, you know, as you say, the other countries that we examined also had many of those interest groups. Australia, Switzerland, Canada, they all have very strong doctor, hospital, and insurance interests, especially before they move toward a universal system. And they continue to be, you know, working with and wrestling with these interest groups even today in these countries. Even in the UK, with its very famous single-payer system, the Minister of Health in the mid-1940s, he won over one of the major doctor associations by, quote, stuffing their mouths with gold. In other words, making sure they remain financially comfortable. So they figured out a way to bring them in and get their buy-in so that they would participate in whatever was to happen next. So there are ways to navigate these issues. I think we need to, you know, keep trying to figure out how to do that.
Indeed.
Yes. Thank you. May I just jump in here?
Of course, May.
No,
always.
Thank you for saying that, Jason, because this reminds me of what Uwe Reinhardt said, and I quote him, that he says, yes, you bribe them. You bribe the providers so that they will work with you. But then I would also like to add that in these other countries, I think the providers, hospitals and doctors and allied healthcare workers, they, because they believe that healthcare is a right, and it should be affordable to everyone or to government to finance it. So they're not, there's generally a consensus. In Europe, for example, the healthcare systems, there's understanding that usually, you know, healthcare spending growth, they don't let it go above like one percentage point than GDP growth. Okay, so then that becomes manageable. The healthcare cost growth is manageable, and people have, the societies have an understanding and accept that. But in this country, we historically have the healthcare sector have always grown 2 to 2.5 percentage points faster than GDP, and this trend will continue this decade and beyond. We know that. I mean, the Congressional Budget Office have done the numbers. The CMS have done the numbers. We know that. But again, because our provider, our supply side is so very powerful because of these special interest groups, which is allowed because of our political system. So it's like we're trapped in this vicious cycle.
I would love to turn to some of the examples that we looked at and to see if there are particular threads there that might have some lesson to be learned for the U.S. And Ashish, I hear your words constantly to say, stop trying to think that we're going to graft, say, Switzerland's system onto the United States. They're wildly different countries, wildly different cultures. And I hear all of the caution that you're saying in that regard. But I'd like to read one question that has come in here. This is, excuse me, it is... Prominence on YouTube asks, Would the U.S. as a whole benefit if we were to cut out the middleman by removing our current health insurance companies and replacing it with a national healthcare service? Obviously, that idea is an enormously tricky undertaking. I mean, it's an enormous industry and they're not going to go anywhere soon. But the United Kingdom, in its National Health Service, does not have traditional insurance companies the way we think of them here in the U.S. And to that system, Ashish, we saw while we were there an organization called NICE in the U.K., and it is really the government's cost control mechanism, one of the principal ones. And what they do is they're arguing, in essence, if we have, say, only $100 to spend on medicine and healthcare for the whole country, but we have $125 worth of need, we have to make these choices. And so this body makes those decisions that then trickle throughout the system. Do you think that kind of a system could work here in the U.S.?
Yeah, I mean, there's this idea of a cost effectiveness, what people talk about as health technology assessment. The idea simply is you look at individual therapies and ask, is it worth it? Is it worth that extra dollar? And you can have a collective decision the way NICE makes it, and that has huge ripple down effects on NHS. NHS largely follows NICE recommendations. There are a couple of issues. I mean, one issue of is it worth it? Is it begs the question for whom and who's paying for it. It's one thing to say, is it worth it for the government to pay for it? But you know, there are going to be people who are going to say, it may not be worth it for you, but it is for me. And there are going to be private insurers who are going to be willing to offer products that include those things. That's one part of it. Even in the UK, we have seen a lot of pushback over the years. I mean, there are moments when NICE is doing great, and there are other moments where politicians very much target NICE recommendations and go and basically go around it and offer to put in money for things that NICE has said are not worth it. So it's not like it's all homogenous, everything is great in the UK, and there's no debate on these things. It's a constant ongoing struggle, because what happens is there are going to be winners and losers. I mean, the thing that we talked about when we were in the UK together was the big upside of the UK's decisions around rationing, and let's just be honest, it's a level of rationing, is that it's different than the rationing we do. Let's be honest, America does rationing. Every country rations on some level. The question is how and for whom and how open and explicit is it? And what I love about NICE and what I love about the UK system is that it's very explicit about its rationing. You can disagree with it, you can dislike it, you can push back against it. America does it much more implicitly, and America does it in a way that way disproportionately harms poor people, people who have fewer resources. And so that kind of implicit biased rationing is the one that I'm much more likely to push back against. But in some ways I didn't quite answer your question. Do I think a NICE-like system is possible in the US? You know, we keep talking about it. We have private sector versions of that. There's something called ICER that is trying to do this with private insurance companies. But I think politically it's pretty hard. It's hard for me to imagine a national system that Medicare is going to then listen to and make its coverage decisions. I think it's going to be very, very difficult. I just don't see it anytime in the near future.
Can I add something about
that? Yes, of course, May.
I'm sorry, but I think NICE, I just like to make something very, very clear about the mission of NICE. And this is something that Americans, more Americans should know about. NICE, National Institute for Health and Care Excellence of the UK, it makes the NHS coverage decisions based on two criteria. The first one is clinical effectiveness. The second one is cost effectiveness. Any new treatment and any new drug must meet both criteria for NICE to recommend NHS coverage. Whatever NICE recommends, NHS must cover, find the money to cover it. But because the UK NHS is a budgeted system, they only have so much to spend. I think they, you know, their health spending is like 10% of their GDP. We're spending 17-18% of GDP. So their budgeted system, of course, has limits. You hit a ceiling, right? So NICE uses what's called a threshold, you know. Anything that does not meet the cost effectiveness of a certain threshold they don't cover. And that threshold has been at 30,000 pounds.
Right.
So then, but we don't have that. You see, here, the politicians, governments have been trying, both Republican and Democrats, have been trying to lobby the Congress to allow Medicare to negotiate prices with providers. But so far, it's dead on arrival. So we as a nation will not look at cost effectiveness as a criteria for coverage. And so that's another reason why our care is so expensive, in addition to the high prices, in addition to the high administrative costs.
Jason Kane, I wonder if you could just help us understand one of the genesis, another for this series was the Biden administration coming into office and trying to address healthcare reform itself. Can you just give us a quick synopsis of what Biden has already done and what he is proposing to do as possible fixes?
Sure. They've been incremental steps so far. The Biden administration is encouraging more Americans to get covered under the Affordable Care Act, which was set up by President Obama when Biden was vice president, had a big role in that as well. So that is what they're focusing on at the moment. They extended the special enrollment period for people to sign up for coverage this spring so that, you know, more folks could get coverage, and also expanded subsidies for that insurance through the recent COVID relief law. And they've also added new incentives for states that haven't expanded Medicaid under the ACA to do that. So these are small steps so far. The Biden administration is thinking about some bigger moves, perhaps the public option that we've talked about, although that will be very politically contentious. So we'll see if they go for anything bigger here in the coming months or years.
May, the same question to you. What is your sense of what is the most politically feasible reforms that might happen in the next 3 years or so that could increase more Americans' ability to get affordable health care?
I think I'd like to just say I totally agree with Jason that, you know, making more subsidies available to people who sign up on ACA, Affordable Care Act exchanges. This will enroll many more people. Just like in California, I read just yesterday that, you know, there's a big article about how health insurance with this Biden's initiative, which he wants to make permanent. So in other words, you know, to raise the subsidy, eligibility level high so that many more previously ineligible people will become eligible to get the subsidies. And so naturally, then more people will say, oh, now it's affordable, so I'm going to get it. So that's one. And I hope it becomes permanent. It's part of this American rescue plan. And the second route is Medicare and Medicaid expansion. Medicaid is our program for the low-income Americans. Medicaid expansion has covered many more Americans, millions. But we still have 12 states which today have not expanded Medicaid. And so the Biden government is trying to bribe them. Say, I give you more money, just expand it, just do it. And that's a work in progress, we don't know. But if Medicaid expansion did happen, we can cover, I just read this number, 8 million more Americans with Medicaid expansion. And that would considerably reduce the number of uninsured in this country.
That would be a big dent in the uninsured population right off the bat. Ashish, do you think that is likely? I mean, I know that sometimes comes down to a state political decision, but do you think that kind of expansion is the ticket to get closer to universal coverage?
Yeah, you know, one of the lessons from when we went traveling to all these countries, and when you look at all the nations, is that they all have universal coverage and they've all gotten there in slightly different ways. And America, I do believe, and I'm going to sound maybe hopelessly optimistic, I think we are going to get to universal coverage, but we are going to get to universal coverage through this kind of incrementalism, that we're going to improve the ACA exchanges in a way that allow more people to come in and get coverage that way. I'm hopeful, and you know, maybe this has been it's been a long time to be hopeful that the rest of the states will expand coverage. But I think over time that pressure will continue to build as we pull out of this pandemic. People realizing that a pandemic is a horrible thing to go through. A pandemic is a particularly horrible thing to go through uncovered. Will hopefully create more political pressure for states to expand Medicaid. And this is how we're going to get into the mid-90s and hopefully into the upper 90s in terms of coverage. We're at about 90, 91% now. And at, you know, kind of in the most ideal scenario, we'll get to 97, 98%. It's kind of where Massachusetts got to. And we'll continue to have a little bit of a problem with small proportion of people getting being uncovered. But if we can get there, that would be amazing. And I don't know. I feel at this moment like there's an opportunity to push on that last 6, 7, 8%. If we can continue using the tools we have, Medicaid coverage, better opportunities within the ACA. I don't see the Biden administration making any efforts to do wholesale changes like Medicare for All, which I think is going to be, I just think politically is off the table and certainly not necessary if we want to get to universal coverage.
We have to let you and May go in just a few moments, but I'd like to ask one last question, which is a larger societal question. This is a question from Priscilla in Washington State, and she asks, is the American idea of individual freedom a barrier to U.S. citizens' willingness to support universal health care? I know, May, we've talked about this in the past, this question of whether there is really a national consensus that this is something we want to spend the money and the time and the effort. And as Ashish says, sometimes pick winners and losers to achieve this. Do you think that that is, that that consensus is possible in America?
Not in my lifetime, I don't see it because of this ideological divide that I mentioned earlier. So we will always have a very large percent of Americans who say, you know, government stay out of my healthcare. And it's my business. Don't tell me that I must have health insurance. And this is just not the case in other countries. See, I mean, even in the private health insurance system of Switzerland, there is a mandate to get health insurance. And the Swiss health minister, who was the Swiss guest on your Swiss part of the series, he said the Swiss regard health insurance to be insured a civic duty. Those were his words, a civic duty. And in all other countries, people accept that because they say we want this health insurance for everyone. And the only way to get there is that everyone is insured, regardless of your age, your gender, your health status. Everyone needs to be in there, including the young. But here we get that pushback. Just look at the way we have dealt with the mask mandate in this pandemic.
Right, certainly. Yeah. Ashish, last word to you. I know you have to run. Are you optimistic? May is expressing a little bit of pessimism there.
Yeah, so I'm always nervous when I disagree with May, because usually it turns out I'm wrong. But I will, on this one, gently and very, very respectfully disagree, and on twofold. One is, there's no doubt about it, there's a strong strand of, hey, the government should stay out of my business. But there's also a strong strand, and a majority opinion, in fact, of we should take care of vulnerable people and we should help people who cannot help themselves. And most polls that I'm aware of find a pretty strong majority support for universal coverage. The details is where it starts peeling back a little bit, but majority of people. So I think this is one of the reasons why President Obama was very clear in selling the Affordable Care Act. You know, his like, if you like your insurance and you like your doctor, you can keep them. And so the question is, how do you do this in a way that's the least disruptive for people who are reasonably happy with what they have, even if they find the insurance companies annoying or et cetera, et cetera. So I think there are ways of doing this. The other part that I'm a little surprised by, I have to tell you, is, you know, the Republicans for years have been talking about getting rid of the ACA and repeal and replace and whatever they might replace it with. The one thing they did do was they got rid of the individual mandate, which I was very worried about. And I thought, well, this is really going to be potentially quite harmful. It turned out it has not had a big effect because most people actually want to get health insurance if they can. And so the loss of the individual mandate has not been devastating for our coverage numbers. And I think we can probably move forward and get to, again, that mid to upper 90s with a bunch of policy tweaks. And there may be more than just tweaks, but things that are politically doable without taking away what many Americans might feel is an infringement of their freedom. But really appealing to the broader sense that Americans have that we should care for people who are vulnerable, that we are a generous country. And gosh knows we spend enough money that we can afford it. So maybe I am the eternal optimist here who says maybe in the next few years we can get to closer universal coverage. And obviously that would be a wonderful thing and something that our country desperately, desperately needs.
Get close to universal coverage. But you know, what about that remaining percentage that's, you know, will not be insured?
Even in Massachusetts, we're at like 98%. I guess if we got to 98% of the U.S., I would be thrilled.
Yeah, I would be thrilled, too. I think we all can agree on that. I'm sorry we have to let you go, but Ashish Jha and Tsung-Mei Cheng, thank you both so much for all of your help on this project and for being here today and help us walk through some of the granularities and the larger philosophical questions here. It's a pleasure to see you both. Thank you both very much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you. Great to be with you.
Great to be with you, too. We really cannot thank those two enough. They are two superb contributors to this ongoing conversation in the United States about how we can make healthcare better for everyone. I'm still here with my dear colleague, Jason Kane, who is of the NewsHour's healthcare producer. He was the original creative inspiration behind the first series that we did 2 years ago, looking at several of these nations. He was also the producer of the documentary that we have been talking about, which was called Critical Care. It aired on PBS recently. You can see the whole program on our website. We'll have links to that down below. But before we go today, we've been getting a ton of questions, and my apologies that we haven't been able to get to more of them here. The thing that I would love to turn to you about, Jason, is this question about the pandemic, which is the nightmare that we have lived through in the United States for the last year plus, and which many parts of the country are still struggling with. We kept hearing about, we're traveling to these different countries, looking at their universal healthcare systems. And then as the pandemic emerges, the question keeps coming, does having a universal healthcare system help you fight a pandemic? Does it give you extra tools? And Jason, I just wonder if you could take a crack at sort of summarizing what we have learned about whether or not that is true. Does universal healthcare make it easier to fight a pandemic?
Yeah, I think it's really a mixed bag in a lot of ways. The biggest thing a universal healthcare system does is take away the fear that if you go to the hospital, you're going to incur a bunch of costs that you weren't expecting. You could wind up with a huge bill that could bankrupt you and your family. In Canada, they don't have to worry about that. If they're sick, they can go into the hospital, they can get the care that they need, and they can go home. In America, a lot of people have been so worried about costs. They've stayed home, they've continued going to work, they've infected their families. That's one of the reasons that it's spread a little bit more, or a lot more here in the US, especially in the early days. The more centralized system also allows them to keep track of people, make sure that they're staying home, call them up, make sure that they're getting the care that they need, direct them to the nearest hospital if they need to. And then they also have boards that allow them to kind of task force that allows them to see how full each hospital is and move patients around if needed so that no single hospital becomes overwhelmed like we saw here in the U.S. in places, you know, like New York and Los Angeles and Houston. But it's not a perfect system. For the most part, Canada's system does not cover things like mental health and prescription drugs outside of the hospital. It has large holes in its social safety net There's a lot of poverty. They have a lot of the same troubles with lower income people still feeling the obligation to go to work if they're sick for fear of just losing their wages. So those have been issues. They've also obviously faced a much bigger hurdle when it comes to vaccination, and they've been far behind the U.S. when it comes to that. So this spring, they've actually seen a big surge in cases, a big third wave that they've been very worried about and has started to overwhelm the system a bit, especially with the new variants that are around. But I guess finally, go ahead, William.
No, please.
Finally, on a personal level, it was very interesting just to see the difference in the views of our two systems. When I flew up there for our documentary, I was required to show proof of my quarantine for 2 weeks. A public health official randomly came knocking on my door of the Airbnb I was staying at to make sure I was in there. If I was not in there, I could have faced a huge fine. I could have gone to jail. And then when I came back to the US, I was only required to show proof that I tested negative, and that was it. I was on my way and could do whatever I wanted in the US after that point. So I think there is a difference in just the basic philosophy around healthcare that is pretty evident in that just one example.
It's so true. And certainly one of the things that we saw was a huge fault line here in the United States that seems to be somewhat culturally different in the UK and in Switzerland and in Canada and even in Australia, is that when the government makes requirements of people and says, for public health reasons, we need you to stay home or to wear a mask, et cetera, those cultures largely accept that edict from the government. I mean, there are pockets of resistance in a lot of places, but some people have pointed to the fact that this sort of spirit of freedom and individualism in the United States and a skepticism towards the government has in some ways also hampered our ability to respond to a pandemic, because it's very difficult for a local public health official or a state or even a national public health official to say, please stay home, please wear a mask, please don't go to those bars, because people say, who are you to tell me what to do about my life? But again, as we certainly saw, the United Kingdom, which many people in the US, especially proponents of Medicare for All, hold up as an example of what we could aspire to, they had a terrible time during the pandemic. They had lots of cases and lots of deaths. So having universal coverage, as we've seen, helps in certain ways, but it is not a panacea when it comes to a public health crisis. They're slightly different entities to deal with. Anyway, I'm sorry to say we have to wrap up this conversation, but it's been terrific having Ashish Jha and Tsung-Mei Cheng with us, and of course Jason Kane from the PBS NewsHour. We would like to offer special thanks to the Commonwealth Fund for underwriting this special live conversation. We are grateful to you for your support. And thanks to everyone who has tuned in. We will keep this posted on our website so you can watch this and share this. And you can also see Critical Care, the documentary that we did that was the genesis of a lot of this conversation, on our website. I'm William Brangham from the PBS NewsHour. Thank you all very, very much for joining us today. See you soon.